Congratulations on the purchase of your new CENTROID-equipped CNC milling machine. This is a CENTROID mill training video. In this video, I'm going to show you how to set up, program, and machine a part using the CENTROID CNC control. But before we dive into making parts, I'd like to go over the control power requirements, and I'd like to get you oriented with the operator's console, and I'm going to show you how to home the machine out. So let's go check out the control power requirements so we can get her up and running. Okay, before you ever turn on the power switch, I want you to make sure that the voltage coming in from your source, your power source, matches what's on the outside of the cabinet. We want to make sure that we're not going to risk any damage to the control. I'm going to show you how to hook up the power correctly. I'm going to go ahead and open up the electrical cabinet to the control, and you'll see the disconnect terminal block right in behind the switch. Here we go. Now what we're going to do is I'm going to grab a voltmeter and we're going to check the power coming in. The power coming in is always at the top of the terminal block. Now this is plugged into the wall right now, so these wires are hot, but everything below here is dead because we have the switch turned off. So I do want to be careful around in this area. I got my voltmeter set to AC juice right now. And the first thing I'm going to check is the 220 volt power coming in. This machine is set up as a three-phase machine right now. We got three wires coming into the top, white, red, and black. So I'm going to go ahead and check the juice between L1 and L2. L1 is the terminal the whole way on the left. And between the two legs of L1 and L2 right now, we have, the voltmeter says 212 volts. That's great. Now I'm going to go ahead and check L2 to L3. We're going to see what kind of power we got in between those two. Voltmeter says 213 volts. Looking good. Now you check between L1 and L3. And we have 212 volts there as well. That's looking real good. Now, just because you got three-phase power coming into your building doesn't necessarily mean that it's clean three-phase. The power company could actually be synthesizing the third leg. If that's the case, the third leg, the voltage on that third leg is called the wild leg. It could actually vary radically. You could have anywhere from 280 to 190 volts on that wild leg. To figure out which one of these legs is the wild leg, what you do is you measure from each leg to ground. Now I'm on the ground terminal with one of my voltmeter leads and the other lead is on L1 and I'm measuring 121 volts. That's what you're supposed to get. If I got 223 phase coming in and I measure from one leg to ground, I'm going to get about 110 to 120 volts, somewhere around in there. Now I'm going to go ahead and check the other legs and do the exact same thing. Here we go, 123 volts on L2, that's looking good. So far I haven't found any wild legs yet. Let's check L3. Bingo, 122 volts as well. So this is good, clean juice coming in. So it doesn't really matter where these wires are connected. Now, if I did have a wild leg, what you would find out is from one of these legs to ground, you would not get 120 volts. You would get something else. That's the wild leg. What you want to do is you make sure that that wild leg, whatever wire it is, ends up on the L1 terminal. The reason for that is the control then will isolate that wild leg from the control electronics. So you don't risk any damage to your control by having a 220 wild leg coming into your system. This particular machine is also a dual voltage input machine. So it has 110 coming in through the switch as well. So I'm going to check the top of that terminal block. And sure enough, we have 120 volts AC coming in through there as well. So that's looking real good. CENTROID CNC controls run off of single phase or three phase power. Because of this fact, we strongly discourage the use of a phase converter. With a CENTROID, that's an unnecessary expense and may even cause damage to your control. If you only have single phase power coming into your shop, no problem. The CENTROID will run on 208 or 220 single phase. Okay, let me show you how to set it up for single phase operation. When you have single phase power input, you're only going to have three wires, two hots and a ground. Now on a three-phase power input, you got three hots and a ground, just like you see here. So when we're only using single phase, two hots and a ground, we're going to connect the two hots to L2 and L3 of the disconnect block. So to set this machine up for single phase, I'm going to disconnect the wire I have here on L1. I'm going to pull it back and just cap it off with a wire nut. There we go. We're ready to run the control on 220 volt single phase. It's that easy. Let me plug it in and we'll check it with the voltmeter. There you go, single phase 220 connected up to the control.
The CENTROID control itself does not require three-phase power for operation. Usually the only items on a typical milling machine that require three-phase are the spindle motor and a flood pump. If you plan on running on single-phase power, be sure your control is equipped with a modern AC inverter that has the ability to synthesize the third leg. These new style inverters eliminate the need for a rotary phase converter.
Okay, I just powered up the machine. The control's booting up right now. It's going to take about a minute for it to come up. When it does, it's going to ask me to home out the machine. Now, what exactly is homing? Homing is a technique used by the CENTROID control so that the control will remember your part zero positions even though the power has been removed. This is a great feature because you may have 15-20 minutes in setting an XYZ part zero position on your fixture or vise. You wouldn't want to lose that effort just because you had to power down. Well, the control, when it boots up, it comes up and asks me, it says, press cycle start to send the machine to the home position. And notice I don't have a DRO, I don't have a digital readout display right now because the control doesn't know where it's at. So all I have to do to home the machine out is press cycle start. The homing process has started. It moves one axis at a time. Z-axis first, then Y, then X. Okay, we're all done homing out. I know that because we have our DRO now being displayed. The digital readout, of course, is the current position of the tool relative to the last part zero position that we were using. The control remembers that from day to day. Now we're ready to go use the machine. Well, let's check out the operator's console. I'm going to get you familiar with this. The CENTROID control has a dedicated operator's panel over here for jogging, turning the spindle on and off manually, the coolant and the flood, the mist, and a couple other nice features that we're going to use while we're machining, like the tool check feature, which you can stop and interrupt the job and restart at any point. You also have the feed rate override, emergency stop, and spindle speed override. These controls allow you to override the program feed rate and the program spindle speed on the fly. So if it's machining a little too fast or a little too slow, you can just adjust it with the knob right here. Now, how do I set zeros and how do I set up my tool libraries and program parts? That's all through the software. Now, how I navigate through the software is with the function keys on the keyboard. Right now, we're at what they call the main menu. This is the screen that comes up after homing. It has a whole bunch of choices down at the bottom. Setup, load a job, MDI, run a job, go into the computer-aided machining. A whole bunch of nice choices here for setting part zeros, setting your tools, programming parts, editing G-code, all kinds of good stuff like that. Well, how do I get into these menus? Well, underneath each one of these tabs is a little F1, F2, F3 button. These correspond to the function keys on your keyboard. So if I wanted to go into the setup menu right now, I would simply hit the F1 button on the keyboard. Now I'm in the setup menu. And it gives me a few more choices. The first choice is part, F1, that's setting up your part zeros. I want to go into that menu, so I hit F1 again. Now I'm in the part setup menu. And again, there's a whole bunch of choices related to setting up your part zeros that I can now use with the function keys. Also, another important set of keys to use is the arrow keys on the control. Anytime you have a cursor on the screen, the yellow cursor, you'll be able to move it around with the arrow keys to enter in values. If I would like to back up from the last menu, back up to the last menu that I was just at, all I have to do is hit the escape key. The escape key backs up one menu at a time. If I hit the escape key again, I'm back at the main menu. It's that simple to navigate through the control. Let me show you how to jog the machine around. I'm going to use the operator's panel here to move an axis. Now, when the control is done homing out, by default, it starts out in incremental jog mode. What that means is whenever I hit the jog button, in this case the X positive jog button, that X axis is only going to increment by whatever amount is currently selected on the jog increment buttons. These are the ×1, ×10, ×100 buttons. That is the reason why it's ×1, ×10, ×100, it's a user settable feature in the control. It can be times whatever amount that I choose. Well, from the factory, the controls are set out so that ×1 is 1/10,000 of an inch. ×10 would be 1/1,000 of an inch. And ×100 would be 10/1,000 of an inch. So right now, when we're done homing, if I do nothing but hit the X positive button, you'll notice that every time I hit the X positive button, that axis is jogging over by the ×10 amount, which is 1/1,000 of an inch every time I hit that button. Well, I'd like to get my vise over here in the middle of the travel, so I want to switch over to continuous mode. A continuous mode and incremental mode, you can switch between the two right here with this button. Notice there's a light. When I hit that button and the light is lit, it's a dual function button. That means that when I hit that button and the light is lit, the word that's beside that light, that's the mode that that button is in. So right now, the light's lit and it's the word beside it's incremental. So I'm in incremental mode, and you can see that every time I hit the button, it's moving 1,000 at a time. Well, I'm going to switch over to continuous by hitting that button and the light goes out. Now we're in continuous mode. So what that means is when I hit the X positive jog button, that axis is going to continuously move as long as I hold that button down. A nice feature about the CENTROID is it has dedicated jog buttons for each axis and each direction. So right now I'm holding down the X positive jog key. And as long as I hold that down, that axis continually jogs until I take my finger off the button. Now I'm holding down the X negative jog key. Now keep in mind, this is tool movement. When I'm talking about X negative, that's the tool moving in the negative direction. So while I'm holding the X negative button down, the tool's moving in the negative direction, which means the table's moving to the right. Okay? You gotta always think in tool movements, whether you're programming or jogging, or programming a line in MDI mode. Z is pretty easy to understand because Z down or Z negative is down and Z positive is up. But if I push the Y positive button, which way is that table going to move? Well, Y positive is the tool moving away from us, so the table is going to move towards us. If I choose the Y negative button, the tool has to come towards us, so the table is going to move away. You got to always think about the tool moving through a piece of material. Okay, you know how to power up the machine, you know how to home it out, jog it around, and even get around in the menus a little bit. So let's start making our part. The CENTROID control runs on industry standard G-code. And what's great about the CENTROID is you don't have to know G-codes to both operate and program the machine. It's all completely menu driven with lots of graphics and help screens and fully commented with English throughout. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to break down making any part into 6 easy to follow steps. If you follow making your part in this order of these 6 steps, you're going to have a high degree of success. The steps are, number 1, determine where your XY0 position is going to be for your part. Number 2, figure out what type and size of tools you're going to need to manufacture this part. Number 3, get those tools in tool holders, load them up in the machine, and get the height and diameter offset values set up in the tool library. Number 4, go program that part. Number 5, get your visor fixture up on the table and get your XYZ0 position set with that visor fixture. And number 6, of course, is actually machining the part. Here's the print for the part that we're going to make. And remember, the first step of the process is to determine where on this part are we going to call X, Y, Z, zero. That's step number one. So before you do anything, right now decide by looking at the print where you're going to make your part zero position. So for this particular print, Z0 is pretty easy. Most of the time, it's going to be the same on all your parts. It's going to be the top of your stock. So that's one out of the way. Where are we going to call X and Y 0 for this particular part? Sometimes there's better places than others to choose an XY 0 point. Sometimes it solely depends on the way the print is drawn. If all the dimensions are based off a certain point on the print, it might be advantageous to pick that point as your XY 0 position. That way you don't have to add and subtract a whole bunch of numbers to find out the XY coordinates of the various features on the print. Well, in this case, it looks like a pretty good spot to pick is the center of this circular pocket. A big reason for that is I made up ahead of time a fixture to hold the stock for this particular part. As you can see, I got two clamps on the outside, but what you don't see is the plate underneath here is drilled and tapped so that when I drill this bolt hole circle, I can then bolt this piece of stock to this plate and remove the clamps so I can machine the perimeter of this part. So we're going to pick XY, Z0 being at the center location of this print and Z being the top of my stock. That's step number one. Step two is determining the tools that are necessary to machine the part. Let's look at the print here. It shows a five-hole bolt hole pattern of a quarter-inch diameter on a bolt hole circle. I'm going to use a center drill and a quarter-inch diameter drill to achieve those holes. For the next two features, a circular pocket of an inch and a half diameter and the perimeter, I can actually use the same tools to machine both of those items on this particular part. I happen to have a 2-flute 3/8-inch end mill on hand, so I'm going to go ahead and use that tool to machine the circular pocket and the perimeter. Same tool. So we only need three tools to machine this part. A center drill, a quarter-inch diameter drill, and a 3/8-inch 2-flute end mill. I got these tools loaded up in the tool holders, and we're ready to go on to the next step. Step number three. Step number three is measuring the lengths and diameters of these tools and getting it set up in the Centroid tool library so the control knows how long they are and what diameter they are. Now, even before you go program the part, I want you to get the tools set up in the Centroid tool library. In the tool library, you're going to find two columns, a height offset column and a diameter offset. Each tool that you have is going to have its own unique height and diameter offset. The diameter offset's pretty easy to understand. It's simply the diameter of the tool. This is also where cutter comp gets its value to use. So when the control is using the cutter comp feature, it's going to look in the tool library's diameter offset table for the information about that tool. Now we're going to talk more about cutter comp in the programming section. So all you have to do to set the diameter offset for the tools is measure the diameter of the tool and type that number in. It's that simple. Now the height offset is a little bit more confusing. What the control needs to know is the difference in length of these tools. There's a couple of different ways to come up with the height offset values for your tools. The one I'm going to show you now is probably the easiest method if you have a bed mill or a machining center. Now, if you've got a knee mill, there's a different technique that you have to use, which we're going to show you a little later on in the video. I'm going to show you right now the most common method when using a bed mill or a machining center. Because there's a unique thing about a bed mill or a machining center, is the distance from Z home, which is where we're at right now, which is where the head's going to be when you're done homing out, to the top of the table is always the same. The table doesn't move. The only thing that moves here in the Z is the column. So when the machine's done homing out, that distance from this point to the top of the table is a fixed distance. We're going to use that fact to come up with a height offset value for each individual tool. And the method in a nutshell is we're going to load the tool up into the column and jog down to a point in which we're going to call a reference point. All that is a place on the table in which we're going to decide to measure all our tools from. The control then will remember the distance that it takes to move from the home position to that reference point. And then each tool will have its own unique value, its own unique length.
Now, to start measuring tools on a CENTROID-equipped bed mill or machining center, all you have to do is make sure that the machine is homed out. Here you see that we have the machine powered up with the machine home not set message being displayed, so all we gotta do is hit cycle start to home the machine out. Once the machine is homed out, we need to be in the tool library menu to record the height offset values for each tool. To get to the tool offset library from the main menu, press F1 setup, F2 tool, and then F1 offset. Once you're in the tool offset menu, move the cursor to the height offset value for the tool number that you'd like to measure. In this case, we're measuring tool 1, so we're moving the cursor to height offset value number 1. Now, with the tool loaded up in the spindle, jog that tool down and touch off of the reference position. Remember, a reference position is simply a point in which we choose to measure all our tools from. You could use the top of the table or the top of the vise to set your tools, but the method that we prefer is using a 1-2-3 block or any gauge block placed upon the top of the table. We like using this method because you can move the 1-2-3 block out of the way while you're jogging the tool down. It makes touching off your tools faster and easier. Once you have the tool just touching the top of that gauge block, hit the F2 measure button and the control records the height offset value for that tool. Okay, we're finished up with tool number 1, so let's do a tool change. Press the tool check button to retract the Z-axis to the home position. Now, just as a reminder, the actual height offset values that we're measuring for each tool using this particular method is simply the distance that the machine has to move that particular tool from the home position down to the top of the gauge block. Now, to set up all the other tools that we have to measure, we simply follow the same procedure. So next, we're loading up tool number 2 into the spindle. That's our quarter-inch drill bit. Then we're going to jog on down and touch off the top of the gauge block. To get the tool down close to the gauge block in a hurry, we're using the fast continuous jog mode. Then we switch over to slow continuous mode once we get within an inch or so of the gauge block. Once you get pretty close to the gauge block, switch on over to incremental jog mode. Start out with the increment set on the times 100 setting. Then once you get the tool within 10 or 20 thousandths of the gauge block, switch the increment over to the times 10 setting. This will move the tool down only a thousandth of an inch each time you touch the jog button. Be sure to move the gauge block out of the way each time that you move the tool down. Okay, we have tool 2 just touching the top of the gauge block, so we're going to hit F2 manual to manually measure the height offset of tool number 2. Okay, now we're ready to go measure tool number 3, so we're going to hit tool check to retract the column to the home position for an easy tool change. While we're getting switched over to tool number 3, I'd like to make the point that you don't have to measure your tools in any particular order. We could have just as easily started out measuring tool 3 rather than tool 1. Now for tool 3, we just do the same thing and jog on down and touch off the top of the gauge block and then hit the F2 manual measure button to measure the height offset for that tool. While we're doing that, I'd like to also mention that once you get a tool set up in the CENTROID tool library, the control retains that information. So typically, you only have to measure the height offset value of a tool once. Okay, we've got tool 3, our end mill, touching the top of the gauge block, so it's time to hit F2 manual to manually measure the height offset of tool number 3. And once you're done, go ahead and hit tool check to retract the tool to the tool change position. The final step in measuring the tool heights is to hit F10 save to save the information to the tool library. Okay, we got our tool heights all set up in the tool library. Now it's time to go set up the diameter offsets for each tool. To do that, it's very simple. All we have to do is measure the actual diameter of each tool and type that number in. For tool number 1, our center drill, we're putting in 75 thousandths. And for tool number 2, our drill bit, we're putting in a quarter of an inch, 0.25. And for tool number 3, our end mill, we're coming up with 3/8 of an inch, 0.375. When you're all done typing in the diameters, be sure to hit F10 to save that information into the CENTROID tool library.
All right, we got our tools all set up in the tool library, all ready to go. So it's time to move on to the next step. Step number 4, programming the part. I'm going to show you standing right here in front of the control in just a few minutes of how to program this part. I'm going to use CENTROID's Intercon, which stands for Interactive Conversational Programming Software. What Intercon is going to do for us is it's going to prompt us for the dimensions off our print, and then Intercon will automatically generate the G-codes necessary to machine this part. In addition to Intercon being available on the control, you can also get it for use on your desktop PC. To start programming in Intercon, press the F5 CAM button from the main screen of the control. CAM stands for Computer-Aided Machining. When Intercon starts, it automatically loads the last job that you were working on. Well, we want to do a new job, so I'm going to hit the F1 File button, and it gives us a bunch of choices here to load an existing job or save the existing program that we're working on. Well, F1 says New. That's what I want to hit, the F1 New button, to do a new program, and it asks us for the name of the new program, so I'm going to type in CAM, C-A-M. You can use any combinations of letters and numbers here to name your particular program, whatever you want. Once I've typed the name in, I can hit the F10 Accept button, and Intercon starts a new program. So here we are at the beginning, and Intercon would like to know the initials of whoever's programming this part, so I'm going to type my initials in. And when I'm done typing anything in, I'm going to hit the Enter button to insert that information into that line. The next line is a nice feature. It's the program description line. You can leave this blank, or what I do is I add in a further description describing what exactly is this program that I'm creating. It's a nice feature because when you come back 6 months from now and you have a big long list of programs, this description will be here in addition to the program name, and will give you a better idea of what exactly you're looking at. So I'm going to go ahead and type in CAM4 training on this particular one. Once I've typed all the information in, what I want to do is hit the F10 Accept button. What that does is it takes the information that we typed in and stuffs it into the line that currently has a rectangle around it, which in this case is line 1, the header, which is the beginning of the program. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. I hit F10. It took that information and stuffed it into line 1. Now you'll notice that it's inserted a blank line in between the first and the last line of the program, and it's simply asking us, select the operation you want to insert. And there's a whole bunch of choices down at the bottom. Choices like rapid to a position, linear mill, arc mill, tool change, CAN cycles, there's a whole bunch of stuff in there we're going to come back and talk about. Well, the first thing I want to do is center drill these holes, that bowhole circle, on my print. So the very, very first thing you do, even before you go program the drilling cycle, is you got to do the tool change. You got to get the tool that you want to use. Well, remember, tool number 1 was our center drill, so I'm going to go do a tool change. Hit F4 to do a tool change to tool number 1. So all I have to do is hit number 1 right there and then enter. And you'll notice that Intercon goes and grabs the information out of the tool library. So the height and the diameter offset are here. Also, the position in which the tool change will take place is here. And information like what spindle speed and what direction and flood is all right here. I can change anything, any of these things that I want right now, or I can leave them alone if they're fine. Well, let's go down and talk about the position. The position, this is the position in which the tool change will take place. Well, remember, we decided that X0, Y0 was going to be in the center of our circular pocket in our bolt hole circle. So right now, the tool change position is set at 0, 0. That means the tool change will actually take place above 0, 0. That's fine in this particular case because we have a bed mill with lots of Z travel, so it's not going to be a problem to actually have the tool change take place directly above the part. If you didn't have a machine that had as much Z travel, you might want to make your tool change somewhere away from the X, Y, 0 position of your particular part. You might want to come over 5 inches and up 5 inches. Well, that's where you would type this number in right here for that type of tool change. In this case, we're going to go ahead and leave the tool change at 0 for X and Y. Here's the tool diameter. That's just the information out of the tool library. It looks good. Here's the spindle RPM. Now, if you have an inverter-equipped machine, which most machines today are, this is where it gets its information on how fast the spindle for this particular tool. We have it set to 3,000 RPM. That's fine right now. It's also set for clockwise. And this reminds me, anytime you see a word lit up in Intercon anywhere, you hit the F3 toggle button and you can toggle through your choices. In this case, there's three choices for spindle direction. It's clockwise, counterclockwise, and off. Well, I want to make sure that it's set to clockwise for tool one. And I'm going to make sure that the coolant is turned off. I don't need any flood coolant to do some center drilling. And I'm going to go ahead and hit accept F10. It'll take this information and stuff it over here in the line number two. There you see tool number one. Now it's asking us, hey, what do you want to do with tool number one? Select an operation. And that's back down to all our different choices. Well, we want to do some center drilling on this borehole circle. So under can cycles, F5, I'm going to find a whole bunch of nice can cycles. Here's drilling, boring, tapping, facing, rectangular pocket, circular pocket, frame mill, thread mill, and irregular pocket cleanout. Well, I'm going to be doing some drilling with that center drill, so I'm going to hit F1 into the drilling menu, and I have four more choices in here. Drill a hole, drill a borehole circle, drill an array, or do a repeat drilling cycle. Well, we're doing a borehole circle, so I'm going to hit F2. Now, the information that it needs to know to drill a borehole circle shows up in the right-hand side. These are the questions that we have to answer to center drill this borehole circle. First question it wants to know is the cycle type. What type of drilling are we going to use? Well, again, the F3 toggle button toggles through the three different types of drilling cycles that are here. There's drilling, deep hole, and chip breaking. Well, I'm going to go ahead and just use a regular drilling cycle because what that does is it feed rates down and rapids out of the hole. And for center drilling, that's all you need. I don't need to use a chip breaking or a deep hole cycle for center drilling since we're drilling at such a shallow depth. The next question it wants to know is where is the center position of that borehole circle? Well, again, here's our borehole circle. Where's the center? X0, Y0. So I just make sure that X reads 0 and Y reads 0 for this particular case. Now, if that borehole circle was out here, you would measure the distance from X0, Y0 to that borehole circle. Remember, everything right now is in absolute positioning. Everything's measured from this particular point. We've made our life easy because we've picked our X0, Y0 to be in the center of that borehole circle. So I'm going to go ahead and leave X set to 0 and Y set to 0. The next question it wants to know is surface height. Well, I'm really not quite sure what surface height is. So what I can do is I can hit the F5 help button and a nice graphical display shows up in the left-hand side of the screen of whatever you're working on. So for all the operations inside of Intercon, you have a graphical help screen that helps you understand what it's asking for, what kind of information it needs to know to do that machining operation. These are also all in the manual, so you could open up the manual and look at these as well. Well, the surface height is simply where is the top of the hole relative to Z0. Well, remember, in step number one, we decided that the top of our part is Z0, so our holes start at the top of the part. So the top of the holes and the top of the part are both Z0, so that's our surface height is Z0. So we can just leave the surface height set at 0. The next question it wants to know is the clearance height. Well, since we're drilling five holes on this particular part, when I'm done drilling the first hole, it wants to know how high to lift the tool to machine over and to move over to machine the next hole. So in this case, the default value is set at 1/10 of an inch. Well, that means when it's done drilling the first hole, the tool will be 1/10 of an inch above the workpiece and wrap it over to drill the next hole. So for instance, if you had a clamp in the way, you would certainly want to make your clearance height higher than the height of that clamp so the tool will jump over that clamp to drill the next hole. Well, in our case, nothing's in the way, so 1/10 of an inch is fine. The next question is kind of related to that as well. It's the rapid to depth, and here's the diagram. Basically is how close can the tool rapid to the workpiece? Well, if you did that clearance height at, let's say, an inch high to rapid over to drill the next hole, it's simply asking how close can I rapid to the workpiece. I'm going to set that at 1/10 of an inch as well. The next question is the depth, is how deep do you want these center drills? We're going to go ahead and drill down 1/8 of an inch for these center drills. The question after that is how fast do you want to drill this hole? Well, we're going to use a conservative 7 inches a minute since this is the first time I've machined this part. By the way, when you're done machining a part, you can always go back and tweak these numbers. You can speed up and slow down things very easily with Intercon. The next question is dwell time. Do we want to wait at the bottom of the hole for any length of time? Well, I don't want to wait. I just want it to drill down and wrap it out of there. And the next question is how many holes? Well, from the print, we have 5 holes. So I'm going to type in 5. And you can use enter or down arrow a lot of the times when you're filling in this information. The next question is the radius of these holes. Well, the radius off the print is 1.125, so 1 1/8 inches. So I'm going to go ahead and type that in. And the last question is the start angle. Well, the start angle is always measured from the x-axis counterclockwise. So in this case, it's 45 degrees from the print. That's the start angle to the first hole. That's what this is asking. You can see it here on the diagram. If I would have said 180 degrees, it would have machined a hole right here. If you say 45, there, 90. So you have 90, 180, 270, 360. In that way, counterclockwise from the x-axis. So I'm going to type in 45 degrees, and I'll be sure to get a hole right there. And one of the great things about Intercon is at any point in time when you're typing this information in, you can hit graph, and you will actually see a graph of the G-code that it just got done generating. This is a really nice feature because it's easy to bounce back and forth between entering in the data and seeing the graph of the G-code. Okay, I like the way the graph looks, so I'm going to hit escape to get back to programming the bolt hole circle for the center drill. I like that information there. It looks good on the graph, so I'm going to hit the F10 accept button. Intercon takes that information and stuffs it into line 3 here, the bolt hole circle line, and inserts a blank line below it and asks us to select the next operation. Well, what do we want to do after we're done center drilling those holes? I want to go ahead and drill those holes with the 1/4 inch diameter drill bit. That's tool number 2. So we need to go grab tool number 2 to program that next bolt hole circle. I'm going to go ahead and hit the same F4 tool button, and except this time we're going to type in tool 2 and then press enter. And you'll see the description showed up. We typed that in the tool library. The position in which the tool change takes place is also here. We're going to leave that set to 0, 0 as well. And the height and the diameter offset Intercon pulled out of the tool library. And there's the diameter, and the spindle direction is set to 1200. That again was set in the tool library, or you can change that right here. If I need to change that RPM, I could make that adjustment right here, right now. I want to make sure the spindle's spinning clockwise. I'm going to have the coolant off as well for this first go around. And I'm going to hit F10 accept. Intercon's going to take that information and stuff in the line number 4 over here. You can see it says the tool change. Now it's asking us, what do you want to do with tool number 2? Select the operation. Well, we want to drill those holes, so we're going to do the same thing. We're going to hit F5 can cycles, F1 drill, F2 drill the bolt hole circle. And you'll notice that Intercon actually remembers all the information that we typed in when we did the center drill. So all I have to do is make some small changes to this. I don't have to type the number of holes in again. I don't have to type the angle in again or remember that. There's a big difference, though, between the type of drilling cycle that I'm going to use between the center drilling and the actual drilling, because the drilling is going through an inch thick piece of material, so I'm actually going to drill completely through it. That's going to be a deep hole cycle that I want to use because I want the tool to back up and clear the chips each time it increments down to drill a little bit. So I'm going to use the toggle button to toggle through my choices. There's deep hole, chip breaking, and drilling. Well, that's the deep hole cycle that I want to use, so I'm going to leave it set to that. And now a few more extra questions show up. I'm going to change the depth to a total of 1.2 inches to make up for the drill point so it goes clean through the piece of material. The next question after depth, this is new now, it says increment. What increment is how much do you want Intercon to drill down before it backs out of the hole to clear the chips? I have it set to 1/10 of an inch here. That's a nice conservative number. We're going to go ahead and leave it at that. And the next question is new also. It asks for the rapid clearance. Well, when it's done backing out of the hole, Intercon wants to know how close can I wrap it down to where I left off before I continue machining. And that's 50 thousandths or so. Again, that's the default number, and that's probably fine for what I'm doing here today. The rest of the information stays the same, the number of holes, the angle, the diameter, and the plunge rate. That's all looking good. Okay, I can graph this, and sure enough, you see a larger diameter hole around our center drills on all 5 of the holes. Looks good. Let's talk a little bit about the graph. You'll notice the x-axis and the y-axis are scaled. This is a great feature because when you're looking at the graph, you get an idea how big things are. You also have the capability to look at different views. There's a 2D and 3D view. There's the 3D view right now of our deep hole cycle. You can see the various hash marks. That's it drilling down to the amount in the increment we said and backing completely out of the hole. So it's drilling down a tenth of an inch, backing out, rapiding back down close, continuing on. That's what you're looking at. I'm going to hit the 2D, 3D, F1 button again, back to the top view. If I hit the view button F2, I get a right-hand view looking in from the right-hand side, and then again looking in from the front-hand side. Well, that looks great, so I'm going to go ahead and hit Escape to get out of that and get back to programming, and then press F10 because this information looked good on the graph. When I hit F10, Intercon takes that information and stuffs it into line number 5 here, drilling the bowhole circle. Okay, we're all done programming our bowhole circle, so now we want to tackle that circular pocket in the center of our part. We're going to use our 3/8 inch end mill to both machine the inside of this circular pocket and the perimeter. So before I can go program the circular pocket, what I want to do is grab that tool number 3, our 3/8 inch end mill, and do a tool change. So to do that, I'm going to press F4 tool and type in tool number 3 and press enter. And I'm going to change the description because it's wrong in here. It must be an old description from an old tool that we had in here. I'm typing in 0.375. I'm going to type in EM for end mill. What this description is this description will show up on the screen during a tool change, so it lets the operator know exactly what tool that he should be putting in the spindle. Our position looks good. We're going to continue to do our tool changes at X0, Y0, and the height and diameter offset, it automatically grabbed out of the tool library just like before. Diameter looks good at 0.375. And as I mentioned before, this diameter, this is where cutter comp gets its information. So we will be using cutter comp to machine the perimeter of this particular part. In a CAN cycle, like a circular pocket or rectangular pocket, cutter comp is automatic. So there's no need to turn on cutter comp to machine this circular pocket. The spindle RPM is set at 2700 RPM. That's fine. Make sure it sets clockwise. And I'm going to keep the coolant off as well. And that looks good, so I'm going to hit F10 accept, and it takes that information and it stuffs into line number 6 here, our tool 3, and it's asking us, okay, what do you want to do with tool 3? We want to machine that circular pocket, so we're going to go ahead and hit F5 CAN cycle again. Lots of good stuff in here, but this time we're going to choose the F6 circular pocket button. Here's the information it needs to know for the circular pocket. I'm going to hit the F5 help button to turn on the help screen to help me out here. The first question it wants to know is, where is the center of this circular pocket? Well, the center of the circular pocket is the same as the bolt hole circles. It's at X0, Y0. So we just go ahead and leave that set to X0, Y0. The surface height is 0 as well, same as the holes. The diameter. The diameter of this pocket from the print, it shows a radius of 3/4 inch. So the diameter is 1.5 inches, 1.5 inches. Going to type that in. Next question, it's asking clean out, and we have a choice here. We have a word, so I'm going to hit the toggle button. There's only two choices, yes and no. What clean out is asking is, if I say yes to that, the tool will start in the center and clean out the entire circular pocket. If you say no to that question, the tool starts in the middle, runs out to the inside of the circular pocket, and just runs around it once and comes back into the center. Well, the only time you'd really use no for clean out is if there was already a hole there. And for instance, if you had a casting that had a hole there and you were just cleaning up the inside maybe to set a bearing in that hole. Well, I'm going to say yes in this case because I have a solid piece of material, so I want it to clean out the entire inside of that circular pocket. The next question is, it wants to know how deep of a circular pocket should I make? Well, I want to machine through my 1-inch stock, so I'm going to type in 1 inch and 50 thousandths. Next question after that is the per pass mount. What Intercon has is a nice feature here. It enables you to machine that circular pocket in chunks. So it's simply asking me, how much do you want to machine per pass? Well, I'm going to pick a conservative 0.1 of an inch. That means that Intercon will ramp down to 0.1 of an inch, machine that circular pocket, and then do it again and again and again until it gets to my final depth. The next question is the plunge rate. Plunge rate is how fast in inches a minute will Intercon plunge down to the first per pass depth that we set at 0.1 inch. After that, it wants to know what type of plunge do we want to do. We can straight plunge or do a ramp plunge. Well, I really like to use the ramp plunge because you don't have to have a hole drilled here and you don't have to use a center cutting end mill. And I'm going to type in 15 degrees for the angle for my plunge. In general, the angle that you want to use, you should make that angle smaller for the larger the diameter tool that you're using. A small tool can plunge at a steep angle. A large diameter tool needs a shallower angle. Whatever angle you pick, Intercom will sit here and zigzag down back and forth, almost sawtooth back and forth, down till it gets to that first per pass rate, which we have set at a tenth of an inch. In a lot of the CAN cycles in Intercom, you have separate information for both roughing and finish pass. This is a great feature to have Intercom automatically create a finish pass for us. So the first question it wants to know for the rough cuts is, how do I want to machine the rough cut? And again, I see a word, so I'm going to hit the F3 button to toggle. And there's two choices here, climb and conventional mill. I'm going to go ahead and leave it set on conventional, so I conventional mill out the rough cut. Next question is the step over for the rough cut. What this is how much are we going to step over each revolution as we're machining out? It's basically the tool load. And you'll see the number in here, there's a number already in here, 0.225. What Intercom did is it took 0.6 times our diameter of our tool that we're using to machine this circular pocket. So it already stuffed the number in there. Well, that's a little aggressive for the feed rates and stuff that I'm doing here today. I'm going to be pretty conservative, so I'm going to knock that down to 0.15 of an inch. I could always come back later and bump that up. It's pretty easy to do. And the last question for the rough cut is, how fast do I want to rough out the inside of this circular pocket? I'm going to put in 25 inches a minute. And the first question on the finish pass is, again, how do you want to machine the finish pass? Do you want to climb mill it, conventional mill it, or none? Well, if you leave it set at none, what that means is it will rough to the final diameter, which is an inch and a half. Well, I want a finish pass, so I'm going to leave it set to climb, and then I'm going to give it the finish pass amount. I'm going to type in 0.025. What the finish pass amount is, that's how much the roughing pass will leave for the finish pass. And then we have the last question is the feed rate for the finish pass. So I'm going to slow it down a little bit since we're climb milling, and that'll give us a real nice finish on the inside of our circular pocket. Just like before, at any point, I can hit the graph button and get a graph of what we're working on. And the graph the front view, that's the view that I was looking at last time. You'll see our circular pocket lines here. If I hit the view button again, I get the top view. There you see our circular pocket. What you're looking at are the yellow lines are the center line of the tool, and the red lines are rapids, and the gray lines are what you end up with. That's the outside diameter of the drill that we had spec'd for drilling the holes. Well, let's look at the circular pocket here a second. You can see it cleaning out, conventional milling, cleaning out the inside, roughing it. The inside line of this double line is the last pass on the rough, and the outside line is the finish pass. The finish pass is going to go climb milling, so you see it radiusing off here as it leaves, as it's done with the climb mill, so it doesn't leave a tool mark. That's looking real good, so I'm going to hit escape to get back to programming. This information that we typed in looked good in the graph, so I'm going to hit F10 to accept that into my program. Okay, all we have left to do is to program the lines and the arcs that are necessary to have the cutter run around the perimeter of this part, this contour. Well, this is going to be a little different to program than we did for the circular pocket and the bolt hole circles, because in the circular pocket and the bolt hole circles, we got to use CAN cycles. It's a quick, easy way to program a standard shape. Well, this is not a standard shape to run around the outside, so we're going to have to program this with lines and arcs. And we're going to program the points, the data, off the print, which is the actual endpoints of all these lines and arcs. And we're going to make use of a feature called Cutter Comp, which will automatically offset the tool a half a diameter off the program path. This is a nice feature. It makes programming easier. Well, let's see, where do we want to start here? What I'm going to do is I'm going to pick a place away from the contour, up over here, out of the way. A lot of times it's a good idea to start where there's no material and then machine into the material so you don't have to plunge in the material. So I'm going to start off of this point and come out an inch. So remember, we said our XY zero position's here in the center. So what's the XY position of a point out here an inch away? Well, it would be X minus 1 and Y positive whatever this distance is right here. Well, off the print, The radius shows a 2.45 inches, so from there to there is 2.45. So a point out here where I'm going to start the contour, this is where we're going to start to program, is going to be x negative 1, y positive 2.45. And right now, when we were done with the circular pocket, as you see right here, our end position on the circular pocket says 0, 0, 0.1. That means the tool is sitting right here at 0, 0 when it's done machining the circular pocket, a tenth of an inch above the workpiece. The next move we're going to do a rapid from this position. That'll lift the tool up and wrap it over to this position here so we can begin to program our contour. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to hit F1, rapid, and I'm going to type in the point that we decided to go to start, which is x negative 1 inch and y positive 2.45. The next question is asking me what Z height. Well, when we do that rapid from our zero position to our start of our contour, how high do you want the tool to be? Well, I'm going to lift it up an inch just to be on the safe side. I don't have anything in the way there, but a few bolt heads sticking up about a quarter of an inch or so. But I'm going to go ahead and lift the tool up an inch so when it goes to this point up here, I'm going to clear my clamps or my bolts here that are holding my stock down. How a rapid works, by the way, is the position that you're programming to, if the Z value is higher than the position that you're at, it will always lift Z first, then move X and Y. And the opposite is true is if the Z value that you programmed is lower than where you're going to, it will rapid to that position and then move Z. So a rapid will always be a 2.5D move. It's always going to move Z first or last, depending on whether your point is higher and lower that you're programming to. The next two questions is the angle and length. We can also program lines and rapids using the angle and the length feature. So if I happen to know the angle from there to there and the length of it, I could use that information and type it in. It, by the way, also figured that out for me. So when I typed in my minus 1 positive 2.45 point that I want a rapid to, it figured out the angle and the length for me. There's a neat way to use this that we're going to show you a little later on in the video. Well, I like this rapid here. I can go ahead and hit the graph button and graph it. And I'm going to hit the zoom out button, F8. And you can see our circular pocket and our bolt hole circles. And there's our rapid, rapiding up to this point right here so we can begin our contour. I'm going to hit escape, go back to programming. I like this. I'm going to hit F10, accept the rapid into the program. And we have another line here, and it's asking me what to insert next. Well, the next move I want to do is I'm sitting at this point an inch above the part. I'm going to rapid down close to the workpiece. So I'm going to do another rapid, F1 again. And I'm going to leave the point alone, the information for the XY position at minus 1, 2.45. All I want to do is change the Z value. Right now we're an inch above the workpiece. I'm going to rapid to within a tenth of an inch above the workpiece. So I'm going to put a positive 0.1 in for Z. And I'm going to leave the angle and length information alone. Don't need it on this move. Now I'm going to hit F10 to accept that line into my program. Okay, that last rapid we programmed, the sole purpose of that move was to get from an inch above the part to a tenth of an inch above the part in a quick fashion. Well, what I want to do now is plunge into my workpiece a tenth of an inch deep. I'm going to use a linear mill, an F2 linear mill, to do that. The only thing I'm going to change here is the Z value. I'm not moving an X and Y, I just want it to go straight down. And I want it to plunge into the workpiece below Z0, a tenth of an inch. So I'm going to type in minus 0.1 for the Z value. That'll take us down to a tenth of an inch below the top of the work. Also, I'm going to slow down the feed rate here. It has 20 inches a minute in it. I'm going to slow it down to 7 because I'm doing a straight plunge into my workpiece. What this move is going to do is going to get us at depth for the first pass that I'm going to make on the contour. I'm going to go ahead and hit F10 to accept that. There's our line mill that's getting us to a tenth of an inch below zero. So we're sitting right here now, a tenth of an inch into the workpiece. And the very next move I want to do is going to be moving over here close to the beginning of that arc. And the sole purpose for this move that I'm doing next is simply to get cutter comp turned on and compensated before we get to the workpiece. So let's talk a little bit about cutter comp and how cutter comp works. What cutter comp does is when you turn cutter comp on, it actually takes effect during the first move. So right here, I'm going to turn cutter comp on right now by hitting cutter comp F7, and you got a bunch of choices here. You got off, left, and right. Well, if you say off to cutter comp, which is the default value, whatever you program, whatever lines you program, the center line of the tool is simply going to follow those lines like you see here in black. Well, if I left cutter comp off and had cutter comp follow these lines, my part would end up being small by half a diameter, by a radius, because the tool would be cutting into it. What I want is I want the tool to be on the outside of this line the whole way around the contour. Well, cutter comp will automatically offset the tool for me, so I can program the path of the actual part that I want, and cutter comp automatically creates an offset tool path. That's why it's called cutter compensation. Well, what I want to do here is I want to use cutter comp left, so I'm going to use the F3 toggle button to leave that on left. Let me show you what the difference between left and right is. If I'm moving in this direction and I turn cutter comp left on, you're going to get the result here shown in red. If I turn cutter comp right on, what it would do is move the cutter to the right of the workpiece, and that's the path that we would get. Well, I'm going to move in a clockwise fashion around my part, so I want to be on the outside of my part, so I'm going to use cutter comp left to be on the outside of my part. So I'm going to leave the cutter compensation feature turned on to left, hit F10 to accept. Now we're still sitting right here at depth with cutter comp on. Nothing's happened. When you turn cutter comp on, nothing happens until you program the next line. Well, what I want to do is program a line, and the sole purpose of that line is to simply get the tool compensated. Because remember, cutter comp is going to compensate during that first move. So I'm going to program a line from here where we're at to close to the workpiece but not quite at it, because I'm going to use that line to get the tool compensated. It will move over during that line. And then before it gets to my actual contour, it will already be compensated. So the first move I'm going to do after the cutter comp is a linear mill. And this reminds me, you have to do a straight line move after you turn on cutter comp. Arcs are not allowed during the first move of a cutter comp. After you get this first move done, then you're allowed to do arcs. But for the very, very first move after you turn cutter comp on, you need to have a straight line move. And now I'm going to program that sacrificial move to get compensated. F2 linear, and we're going to change the X value to a minus 0.1. We're going to leave Y and Z alone. That takes us right here to this point. And I'm going to hit F10 to accept that. Now we've done that sacrificial move to get compensated, and I just have a short little move to go here, a straight line to get to the beginning of my arc. I'm going to do another linear move, F2, and I'm going to change the X value to 0. That's just the very beginning of the arc, is 0 for X and Y at 2.45. Z we're leaving alone. Z is going to stay the same the whole way around this contour. And I'm going to go ahead and bump the feed rate up now to 25 inches a minute. And I'm going to hit accept. Now at any point in time, we can hit the graph button to see what we've done, and we're going to see the rapid that we just programmed to the beginning of the sacrificial move. There's the sacrificial move, and the yellow line is the center line of the tool, so you see cutter comp getting compensated, and then a short straight line move to get us to the beginning of the arc. There it is. Hey, that looks great. I'm going to hit escape to go back to programming. I'm going to hit insert to insert the next line. The next line here is I'm going to add an arc in. So I'm going to hit F3 arc. Well, there's four different types of arcs in here. And the reason why there's four different types of arc screens is that depending on the information you have on your print, you match it with the type of arc that is here. It's trying to save you from having to figure stuff out. Well, this stands for endpoint and radius, the first arc type. And I'm going to hit toggle. Go to the next one, it's center point and angle, center point and end point, and 3 point. So I could use any one of these screens to program an arc. Just depends on the information that I have on the print. Well, the information that I have on the print is the end point and the radius, so I'm going to toggle back to that screen, end point and radius. I'm going to come down and type the end point in. Well, what's the end point of this arc? It's 180 degrees away here. So X stays the same at 0, and Y just simply becomes a negative 2.45. So I'm going to come down and type in negative 2.45 for Y. Z stays the same. The radius off the print is 2.45. Next question is, what direction are we moving, clockwise or counterclockwise? Well, we're moving clockwise. It's also asking here, what plane are we machining this particular arc in? Well, we're machining in the XY plane, so I'm going to leave it set to that, but you could hit the toggle button and you'll see two other choices for XZ and YZ. For example, here is a YZ arc move, and then an XZ arc move would look like that. Well, I'm going to leave it set to XY because I want the tool to stay in the XY plane. Connect radius, we're going to leave set at 0. We're going to come back and talk about that. Feed rate stays the same. And the last question is asking, is the angle of the arc that the arc is going through, is it less than or equal to 180? Well, in this case, it's equal to 180 degrees, so I'm going to leave it set to yes. If it was a smaller arc, I would change that to no. And it's often really good to use the graph button to figure out whether you got things set right. There you go, there's our arc. You can see we're cutter compensated the whole way around it. Okay, that looks great. I'm going to hit Escape to go back to programming. I'm going to hit F10 to accept this into my program. Now we're sitting right down here, and I want to program a line. Well, I could program a line from here to somewhere around in here. This line turns into an arc. So you have a line tangent to an arc right here. And that point where that takes place is not on the print. I could actually figure that out using the math help feature in Intercon, but there's an easier way to do this particular one. Since this particular arc connects to two other lines, I'm going to use the connect radius feature on this line when I'm programming this line right here, so that it will automatically throw that arc, that fillet, in there when it connects to the next line. So we're sitting right here right now. What I want to do is program to the end of that line, so where these two lines would intersect is the endpoint of this line. And on the print here, it's giving me that distance and that height. So X would be a negative 3.0640. Let's go ahead and type that in. I'm going to do an F2 linear. I'm going to type in X is a negative. The reason why it's negative, it's to the left of 0. Negative 3.0640 off the print. Well, what's the Y value for this right here? It's off the print at 0.5045. So it's a positive 0.5045. There we go. Z stays the same. Feed rate stays the same. I'm going to hit the graph button to see what we got so far. Well, you see the line that I just got done programming coming out to this point right here, from there to there. Well, you don't see an arc yet because we haven't programmed the next line. As soon as I program the next line, Intercon will automatically throw a radius in between those two lines. So that looks good. I'm going to hit Escape. I'm going to hit F10 to accept this information into my print, into my part. And we're going to do yet another line because right now we're sitting here and I want to do a line mill to this point, back to the beginning. That point is X0, Y, a positive 2.45 off the print. Z stays the same, feed rate stays the same, everything looks good. I'm going to hit the graph button. Let's check it out. Well, look at this. We still have a sharp point here. We don't have a radius. What happened? Well, what happened is I forgot to turn on the connect radius feature in the line that we did before this one. So I'm going to go ahead and hit F10 accept, and this is a good opportunity for me to show you how to go back and edit anything that we've done. We're in insert mode right here, and it's asking us what you want to insert in this new line. Well, I don't want to insert anything, so I'm going to hit Escape, and that takes us back to the edit screen. The edit screen allows you then, with the arrow key, to move the cursor wherever you want in your program. Well, I'm going to highlight line 15 where I forgot to turn the connect radius on and hit the F2 modify button, and look, all that information is right there. So it's real easy for me to get back into line 15 and make any changes that I need to do. Well, the connect radius off the print here, there's a radius between these two lines at 0.8410, so I'm going to type that in, 0.8410. Now if we hit the graph button, there you go. We got our arc in between our two lines. Hey, that looks great. I'm going to hit Escape, and then I'm going to hit Accept to accept that in. I'm going to come down to the end of my program and hit Insert. Now, let's look at this graph for a second. I'm going to hit F8 again, and at the end, this last line, the tool's just stopping right there. In other words, the tool is just touching my part when it stops and it's going to retract. Well, In reality, to make a really, really nice part with a nice finish here, it would be really nice to machine beyond that. So when I come off of this line right here, it would be nice to tell it to go out here somewhere. Well, how do I figure that point out? Well, I'll show you an easy way. I'm going to hit Escape to go back, and I'm going to hit Modify to come back into that last line. Here, remember we typed in the endpoint of that last line, which is 0, 2.45. Well, look what it did. It figured out the angle and the length of that line from there to there. So all I have to do to extend the length of this line at that same angle is simply come down here on the length setting. It's right now at 3.6295, and let's bump it up to 4.5. I'm going to add almost an inch to it. When I do that, voila, it figures out the new XY coordinates of that line. So check it out. Let's hit graph here. And sure enough, I've just machined right beyond the beginning of my part. This would be a good way to do things so you don't end up with a tool mark or a little lip there that you'd have to finish on the bench. Well, that looks great. I'm going to hit Escape and then F10 to accept that change. Well, now what we've done is we programmed this at one pass at a tenth of an inch deep, but the stock is an inch deep. So I want this intercon to automatically create all the passes necessary to machine this piece of stock an inch deep, but a tenth of an inch at a time. So I'm going to hit Insert, and under the Subprogram menu, F9, there's a bunch of choices here: Depth, Repeat, Repeat, Mirror, and Rotate. These allow you to perform any of those operations on any part of your program. You can do the whole program, one line, or just a couple lines. Well, before I do a depth repeat, I need to turn my cutter compensation feature off. This is a common mistake that I almost made here, and a lot of other people make as well. We turn cutter comp on up here at line 11. The rule is you really only want cutter comp on only during the moves that you need cutter comp on. So once you're done running around that first pass, you want to turn the cutter compensation feature off. So I'm going to go back here and hit the S7 button and turn the cutter comp capability to the off position, and I'm going to hit accept. There you go, I just added in comp off line 17. Now I'm going to go to the subprogram menu, F9, and now I'm going to pick the F1 depth repeat button. What depth repeat is take what I've done and repeat it down in Z. That's what I want to do to get these passes to go down to an inch deep. At the beginning of the depth repeat menu, it needs to know is what part of my program do you want to repeat to a depth? Where do you want to begin and where do you want to end? Like I said, you could do one line or the whole program or a couple lines. Well, I need to do a couple lines, so the beginning of my depth repeat is really going to be at the beginning of that cutter comp move. So I'm going to pick that line, which is line 11, type in 11, and the end of my depth repeat move is going to be when I'm back here off the end of the part, done machining that first pass, which is the comp off button, or comp off line here, which is line 17. So I'm going to go ahead and hit 17. Okay, the next question it would like to know is the total depth for the depth repeat. We programmed the first pass at a tenth of an inch deep, but I want it to go down to 1.05, an inch and 50 thousandths, so it machines through the block. So I went ahead and typed that in. The next question is the depth increment. This number usually matches whatever you make your first pass at. So my first pass was a tenth of an inch deep. My depth increment is also going to be a tenth of an inch deep. That means it will continue making these passes of that contour at a tenth of an inch deep until it gets to 1.050. So the next question after that is the clearance height. Clearance height means when it's done making the first pass, it's sitting here and it needs to get back to the beginning. Is how high do you want me to lift the tool to run back? Well, again, if you had a clamp in the way, make that clearance height value higher than your clamp. I don't have anything in the way there, so I can leave it set to 0.1. And the last question is the plunge rate. Well, how fast do you want the tool to plunge once it gets back to the beginning? It remembered what we were using before, so I'm going to leave that set to 7. And it gives you a little warning here saying the operator must program the first pass at the depth increment. All that means is don't program over here an inch deep, okay? Program your first pass over here like we did at a tenth of an inch deep. Let the repeat the depth cycle take you to the final depth. That's what it's trying to tell you. Well, at any point in time, I can hit the graph button. There's the top view. Looks good. Let's go check it out in the 3D view so we can see what we've done. Well, there you go. There's all the passes for that contour to run around the outside of our part to get down to that 1 inch and 50 thousandths depth so we can cut completely through our part. All right, that looks great. I'm gonna go ahead and hit the 2D, 3D button again. You can hit the view button as well to look in. There's the right-hand view. There's the front view. Back to the top view. Boy, it really looks good, so I'm gonna hit escape, and now I'm gonna hit accept to accept the depth repeat into my program. Now we're all done, and it's still in insert mode, so I'm gonna hit escape to get out of that. This is an opportunity here back in the edit mode to go change anything. You can still graph it at any point. Well, I just got done graphing, it really looked good. So what I wanna do is I wanna hit the post button, F10. What that does is it saves your program, and it generates the G-code, and it takes you back to the main screen. Here we are. When we hit the post button in Intercon, Intercon created a G-code program based off the information that we entered in the conversational software. And it named the G-code program the same name but with a different extension here, .cnc. And you can see the current job name that's loaded on the control is cam.cnc. That's the G-code program that Intercon just got done creating for us. And the control automatically loaded it when we hit the post button. You can hit F6 off the main screen here right now, and you will actually see all the G-code that Intercon created. Here I'm going to page down through it, and there's a lot of G-code there that it wrote for us. That looks great. This is a fully functional G-code editor. One thing I want to say is if you use this editor to change any of the G-code, that does not change your Intercon program. Intercon's a one-way door, so if you want to make changes to your Intercon program, go back into Intercon to make those changes. If you have to make changes to your G-code program here, go into the File menu and save this as a different name before you make any changes. Otherwise, Intercon will overwrite any changes that you've made next time you hit Post. Well, I'm going to go ahead and hit File and hit the Quit button, F9, to get back to the main screen. We're all done, ready to go. I can hit the graph button and graph it here off the main screen. Looks good. Now it's time to move on to the next step and set our part zero positions. We need to get the DRO to read XYZ zero when the tool's in the center of our part there, center of our circular pocket on the top of our part. But before we go do that, I want to show you one last interesting feature in Intercon. There's lots of other stuff in Intercon like thread milling and teach mode and a bunch of good stuff that we didn't talk about that's in the manual. I want you to go look at the manual and check those things out. But one feature that I do want to show you that I use all the time is the ability, it's like a live calculator that Intercon has here. For an example, I'm going to go ahead and hit insert and then line to insert another line. And up here, anywhere you have to type information in, any numbers in for Intercon, you can actually bring a calculator up on the screen so you don't have to add or subtract or divide numbers together. All I have to do is hit the equals button and it says enter the expression. So for instance, if I had to add an inch and a half to the number that was here in the X value, I'm going to type 1.5 plus and type that number in 0.7349, and all I have to do now is hit enter, and Intercon stuffs that number, whatever that comes out to be, 2.2349. It added an inch and a half to that number that was there. This is a really nice feature so you don't have to go scrambling for a calculator while you're programming in Intercon. Okay, we got that part all programmed up. So now it's time to move on to the next step. Step number five. Step number five is setting your part zero positions. Now, if you remember, way back in step one, we made some decisions. We decided that the XY zero position for programming this part was going to be at the center of this circular pocket. And I told you that I had a fixture plate machined up ahead of time that had the same bolt hole pattern as our part. This was so that when we're done machining the bolt hole circle, I can then bolt the stock down to the fixture plate and remove the clamps, which will then allow me to machine the perimeter of the part. Well, we need to get our program lined up with the fixture plate. So I need to have the XY zero position of the DRO line up with the circular pocket in my fixture plate. Let me go show you how that's done.
The best way to set part zero positions on a centroid is using the optional centroid touch probe. The touch probe will automatically find and set the center points of circular pockets, edges, inside corners, outside corners. It's simply the fastest, best way to set a part zero position. If you don't have a centroid touch probe, you'll have to use the old time-consuming traditional tools for setting your part zero positions. Whether you use the automatic touch probe or an old-fashioned center finder to set your part zero positions, we'll be using the same part setup menu in the control.
To get to the part setup menu from the main screen of the control, press F1 Setup, F1 Part. This is the part setup menu, and we can use this screen right here to set our X, Y, and Z0 positions using any method. So no matter if we're using the automatic touch probe, or an edge finder, or a center finder, or even just positioning the tool to a position and setting zeros, we can do that right here with this screen. The X axis comes up first. It wants us to set the zero positions for the X first. Well, if I needed to set for another axis, I would push the F1 next axis button, and it would switch to the next axis. Now you see it's on Y, now it's on Z, and now we're back to X. Well, the graphic shows an edge finder here. We could use this screen to use an edge finder and set a zero position on an edge, whether it be the left or the right-hand side of the block. But in our case, we're setting a zero position in the center of a circular pocket. So what we need to do is move the cursor over here to the approach from setting and use the space bar to change that to center. There's three choices here: center, right, and left. Well, the left and right are used for when you're touching off with an edge finder. We're not doing that. We're using a center finder. So we're going to leave this on center. And all we have to do then, if we're setting this with the probe, is hit the F5 probe button and pick bore. There's a whole bunch of choices of common shapes that you can probe right here. Bores, bosses, slots, webs, inside corners, outside corners, or one axis. We're going to probe a bore, so I'm going to hit F1 and follow the instructions. All I need to do is position the probe tip within the bore, just like the instructions say, and press cycle start. Okay, the probe's found the center of the circular pocket, and it's waiting for us to set the position. I could type in any number I wanted right here. If I needed to call the center of that circular pocket something else other than 00, that's where you type this number in right here, the part position. Well, we did want it to be set to 0, so I'm going to leave the X0 part position set where it's at. The edge finder diameter doesn't matter since we're setting a center. I can just leave that alone. And I want to make sure that I have the approach from set to center. And when I hit the F10 set button right now, it's going to zero out the X axis. Now the probe's still sitting in the center of the circular pocket, so all I have to do is hit the F1 next axis button to switch to Y for the Y axis. Make sure the part position reads 0. Make sure the approach from reads center. I'm going to change that to center and hit F10. There we go. We just got done zeroing out our X and Y zero position with the probe sitting in the center of the circular pocket. You would basically do the same thing with the center finder. You would center find out using the jog buttons. You would get the center finder set perfectly in the center of the circular pocket and then use the approach from center feature here and make sure it's set to zero and hit F10. It's just the probe's a lot faster. You don't have to spend all the time fiddling with the center finder. Now to set Z, I'm going to hit F1 next axis. And this is a little different. What we're going to do is come down and touch off the top of the part, but we're going to use a piece of paper which is about 2/1 of an inch thick. So I'm going to type in 2/1 for the part position. In other words, the tool is not really touching the top of the workpiece, it's touching a piece of paper which is 2/1 above it. So I'm typing in 2/1, that's the position that we're touching. And this is very important. Remember I said you can use any tool in the tool library to set your Z0 position. Well, you can use any tool that's in there, just like I said, but when you're setting the position, you have to tell the control right now what tool number you're using. Well, we just happened to be using tool 1 because that was the first one in our program, so I'm typed in 1 and I hit set. There we go. We just zeroed out our Z0 position. And again, Z is reading 2/1 above 0 because that's the thickness of the piece of paper between the tool and the 0 position. All right, we got our XYZ 0 position set. Now it's time to go machine the part. To start running our program, I'm going to press the cycle start button 2 times. The first time I press cycle start, it loads the G-code of the part we just got done programming. The second time I press cycle start, it's going to start running that job. Now remember, what's the first thing that we programmed? We programmed a tool change. So the second time I hit cycle start, it's going to go to that tool change position. Now before I do that, remember, I want you to turn down the feed rate override knob so I'm in total control of the machine. I'm going to go ahead and hit the cycle start button the second time, and right now it's actually moving to the tool change position. It's moving very slow because I have the feed rate override knob turned down. Now I'm going to speed it up. Now remember, the home position that we chose, that we programmed in our tool change, was X0, Y0, Z home, which is where we're at right now. The control reached that position, it has stopped, and it's asking us to insert the tool and press cycle start to continue, and it's letting us know that it's asking for tool 1, the center drill. Well, we already have the center drill in the machine since we used it to touch off for our Z0 position. So I'm ready to go to hit cycle start again, and it's going to start performing the operations that we programmed for that particular tool, which happens to be all the center drilling operations on our bowhole circle. So again, I'm going to turn down the feed rate override knob, hit cycle start, the spindle turns on, and now the control is moving to that first hole, that first center drill on that bowhole circle. Now I'm in control with the knob. Things are moving slow because I got it turned down. I'm going to speed things up a little. You can see the Z-axis coming down. I can speed up and slow it down, no problem. Now what I like to do is I like to press the feed hold button, especially on a program, the first time I've ever run it and the first time I've ever run this tool. Because what I want to do is I want to do what they call a reality check, is I want to make sure that the DRO is lining up with what I'm seeing going on down here. So for instance, right now, the Z-axis DRO is reading 4.6 inches. That means the top of that tool should be 4.6 inches above the top of our part, because that's where we called Z0. This is a reality check. Now, looking at that, it looks pretty good. It looks about 4.6 inches above the part. Now, if you had some crazy number in there, like 11 inches, and it didn't look like it was 11 inches above the part, you either have a programming error, or you haven't set up your tools, or you haven't set your Z0 position properly. So that's the reality check. Before you go on, make sure that your DRO is making sense to what's going on. Now I'm going to hit cycle start, and it's going to continue on. I'm going to speed it up a little bit, and I'm going to hit feed hold one more time. Now the DRO says 0.6 inches. I'm going to do another visual check, make sure that looks like about 0.6 inches above the part. It sure does. We're looking good. So I'm going to hit cycle start to continue to release the feed hold, and I'm going to turn up the feed rate. There we are. We're drilling. We're center drilling those holes in that bowl hole circle. There's 5 holes. Okay, there goes the last one. Now the Z-axis is retracting to the tool change position again, and it's asking us to insert the second tool, the drill bit. Let's go do that. Okay, I got tool 2 loaded up. Now when I press cycle start, I am again going to turn down the feed rate override knob so everything goes really slow. And when that starts coming down, I'm going to press feed hold to do a reality check on tool 2 as well. Let's go ahead and do it. Spindle turns on, Z-axis is coming down. Let's hit the feed hold button. Let's check that out. DRO says about 3 inches. Quick visual check, 3 inches is looking pretty good. I'm going to let it go a little further. Stop it one more time. DRO says 0.3 inches. Oh, that's looking pretty good. Looks to be about 0.3. So we got her all programmed right. The tool heights are set right. I'm going to turn the knob down a little bit, hit cycle start to continue. And now we're drilling holes. And remember, we did a deep hole cycle, so you see it pecking down the amount that we programmed, retracting completely out of the hole to clear the chips. There are 2 other drilling cycles as well. There's a chip breaking, which will stay in the hole and just back up a little bit. And then there's just regular drilling, which will feed rate down and wrap it out of the hole. Now at any point in time, you can mash E-stop. Don't worry about that. You will not lose position. As a matter of fact, with the centroid, you can start right back where you left off. It's a really nice feature. I release E-stop, I can hit tool check. Tool check is always going to retract the Z straight up. Now to actually start back where we left off, I can go into the run screen, hit the search button, and right here it says enter the search line or block number. You can start at any point in your program with this particular feature. Well, when I hit E-stop, the control's smart enough that it remembers the line that I hit E-stop on. And it's giving me an opportunity to back up a line or two or else restart right where I left off. If I want to restart right where I left off, I hit F10 to accept that, and then I can hit cycle start, and away we go. It's going to start right back where I hit E-stop. And again, I'm in control with the knob here.
After we proofed out our program on that first run, we went back into Intercon and increased the feeds and speeds and turned on the flood so we can really crank a few of these parts out. One of the nicest features about a Centroid is the ability to stop and retract the tool right in the middle of the job. When you press the tool check button while you're machining, the spindle will stop and the Z-axis will retract to the home position. Being able to stop machining in the middle of the job and pick right back up where you left off is a very useful feature. You can stop machining right in the middle of the job to check out the tool to make sure it's okay, or clear away chips, or check your fixture, or like you see here, we're checking the diameter of our circular pocket, making sure everything's okay. To start back machining in the middle of the tool check, I'm jogging the tool down close to the workpiece, and then all I gotta do is hit the cycle start button 2 times. The machine will automatically restart at the beginning of the line or the arc that it was on when we pressed the tool check button. Okay, we're all done machining that circular pocket, so we're bolting down the sock so we can machine the contour. What we did is we went into back in Intercon and we inserted a stop and wait for operator in between the circular pocket and the beginning of the contour. So the machine will retract to the home position and shut the spindle and the flood off, and that'll give us a chance to bolt down the stock. All we got to do is press cycle start after that. We're prompted by that on the screen and we'll begin machining the contour. Okay, there you see the last pass of the contour. Remember, we machined a tenth of an inch at a time on the depth repeat, so this last pass has only taken off 50 thousandths. There we go, we're all done, ready to clear the chips away and unbolt that part.
Now that I've shown you how to program lines and arcs with CutterCop and a few canned cycles using the CENTROID CNC control and Intercon, you'll be ready to tackle those everyday jobs. If you'd like some more practice, check out the tutorials in the user's manual. They'll take you through step-by-step programming a couple more parts. Also, keep in mind we offer on-site CNC training nationwide, so give us a call or check out our website, CentroidCNC.com, to find out the phone number of the representative nearest you. And good luck with your CNC projects.